Today's scripture that Ben wrote for us in the Gospel of John is probably one of the most shocking pericopes to me. In the story of Jesus' life, we usually see and hear about Jesus' compassion. We hear of numerous healing stories. We hear of Jesus' teachings to turn the other cheek. We hear of Jesus telling us to share our coat with a stranger. All of a sudden, this story smacks us in the face. Where did this mild-mannered, meek, kind Jesus disappear to? Who is this destructive Jesus, turning over tables and spilling out coins and chasing merchants out of the temple? Let's take a look at a modern-day example to see if we can glean some insight as to what happened. Two friends, let's call them Bill and Tom, were drinking coffee at an all-night cafe. They got into a discussion about the difference between irritation, anger, and rage. At about 1 a.m., Bill said, "Look, Tom, I'll show you an example of irritation." He took out his cell phone and dialed a random number. The phone rang and rang and rang. Finally, when a sleepy voice at the other end answered, Bill said, "I'd like to speak to Jones." "There's no one here named Jones," the disgruntled man replied as he hung up. "That," Bill said to Tom, "is a man who is irritated." An hour later at 2 a.m., Bill said, "Now I'll show you a man who is angry." He dialed the same number and let it ring. Eventually, the same sleepy voice answered the phone. Bill asked, "May I please speak with Jones?" "There's no one here named Jones," came the angry reply, this time louder. The man slammed down the receiver. An hour later, you know what's going to happen? At 3 a.m., Bill said, "Now I'll show you an example of rage." He dialed the same number and let it ring. When the sleepy man finally answered, Bill said, "Hi, this is Jones. Have there been any calls for me?" I can just picture myself as this sleepy woman. 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock. I hope you can relate as well. Anger is one of those emotions that we have to deal with. And the Bible tells us that the sun should not go down on our anger. If God is love, then where does anger come from? Is someone going to answer that?
Satan,
yes. Thank you, JJ. Is anger a valid emotion? I personally struggled with this emotion for many, many years. This is a personal testimony. I didn't like what I saw when I saw people get angry, so I figured I am never, ever going to exhibit those qualities. And I did that at a very young age. I decided that I was never going to get angry, or at least show anyone that I was angry. And that worked until I became a teenager. You know those teenage years. So when something bothered me, I would just ignore it until it got to be so terrible that I would just stuff the anger way down deep inside so that it would not surface and it would not cause me to act in a way that I didn't like to see in others. However, over a period of 20 years, all that suffering eventually built up, and it had to surface, almost like a volcano erupting. Now, my temperament would not allow me to hit anything, so that wasn't the solution. My temperament would also not allow me to yell or raise my voice uncontrollably, so that wasn't an option. What was I to do with my anger? Since I didn't know what to do with it, it did something to me. It took its toll on me physically in the way of extremely painful headaches. And when I went for help, the doctor told me to punch my pillow, but he knew I didn't have it in me to even do that. I was a peace lover, and all I had ever wished for when we went to have Thanksgiving dinner at my grandmother's house and got the wishbone was for world peace. I couldn't even punch an inanimate object. I had to learn that anger was a valid emotion, an expression of what happens when you experience something that is unjust. I learned to recognize that as a peace-loving person who never showed anger, I became a target to become a doormat that people could just step all over and take advantage of. That was not what I wanted either. Anger and controlling anger is a difficult learning experience. I think we can learn a lot from Jesus' example. To look at this situation from yet another perspective, let's take a look at an illustration from C.S. Lewis' Voyage of the Dawn Treader. How many of you are C.S. Lewis fans? I figured, actually. Yes, yes, a few. All right, great. So you know the story of Lucy and Edmund, and they're engaged in their adventure when they come to a large grassy expanse. And the sensuous green of the grass spreads off into the blue horizon, except for a little white spot in the middle of the green meadow. And as Edmund and Lucy look at this spot intently, they have difficulty making out what it is. And being adventurous, they travel across the grass until finally the white spot comes into view. It is a lamb. The lamb, white and pure, is cooking a fish breakfast. The lamb gives Lucy and Edmund the most delicious breakfast they have ever had. And after they have eaten, a wonderful conversation ensues as they talk about how to get to the land of Aslan, which is heaven. As the lamb begins to explain the way, a marvelous thing happens. As Lewis records it, his snowy white flushed into tawny gold and his size changed and he was Aslan himself, towering above them and scattering light from his mane. There is a great truth in this story that will help us to understand our gospel lesson today. The qualities that we consider lamb-like, gentleness, innocence, are indeed in Christ, but so are the qualities of the majesty and ferocity of a lion. The lamb is a lion. The Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world is the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Jesus demonstrates that we are not to just allow ourselves to become doormats. Controlling our anger is one thing, but we are not to let others take advantage and get away with murder. Let's look at the sacredness of the temple. First of all, it was a holy place. The fact that it was holy meant that it was set aside for God. Jesus had no problems with the shop owners that were lining the streets of Jerusalem. Jesus knew that business was being carried out there. I know one of my sermons previously, I talked about the mitzvot, the 613 laws, but since we have guests here this morning, you may not be familiar with all those 613. Actually, we had to memorize them, so we know them by heart. Just kidding. The Jews had to observe these 613 laws. And within these laws, there was a category on business practice. Law number 170, which the Jews would have known, not to do wrong in buying or selling. You can find that law in Leviticus chapter 25, verse 14. Law number 181, also from Leviticus chapter 19, verse 35, not to commit fraud in measuring. And in verse 36, to ensure that scales and weights are correct. And law number 183 from Deuteronomy 25, 13 to 14, not to possess inaccurate measures and weights. So in addition to these business practices, there were 32 laws regarding the temple, the sanctuary, and sacred objects. There were strict laws regarding cleanliness of the priests, washing of hands and feet, combed hair, and wearing clothing that was not torn. There were laws forbidding entrance into the temple if one was intoxicated. The sanctuary was to be revered. It is this last law that I would like to share some personal experience over the years growing up in the church and then expanding my horizons to other congregations. As a child, the altar and the chancel area around it were strictly forbidden by anyone except the pastor, the acolyte, and those assisting with worship. One summer during vacation Bible school, I noticed some children running up to the altar and playing on the altar rail. I was in shock. This sacred, holy space was not being revered or respected. Did these children not understand that this was a holy space? They had their backyards and their playgrounds and their ballparks and their houses to play in. Why couldn't they respect this one place set aside for God? I believe we have a similar situation here in John's Gospel. Here he was in the temple, a holy place, set aside for God, not being respected, and even worse, being defiled by unlawful business practice, cheating when exchanging currencies and unbalanced scales. No wonder Jesus screamed, "My temple should be a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves. Get out! Get out!" Can't you just sympathize with Jesus? His anguish. Here he is revealing his fate, knowing he is to be crucified in the near future. God's chosen people out of control. They've lost their respect for what is sacred. They are not only sinning against other people, but by defiling the temple, they are also sinning against God. It was more than Jesus could take. To make matters worse, the timing of turning the temple into a marketplace was even more irreverent. Once a year, it was expected that the Jewish believer would make a pilgrimage to Jerusalem for Passover. It was a week-long festival. And the Passover was a one-day event, and then the Feast of Unleavened Bread lasted the rest of the week. This is the scenario that we observe at the beginning of the text. It says in verse 13, "The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem." This time was regarded as the most important Jewish holiday. Imagine how Jesus must have felt as he made the pilgrimage to the temple to celebrate the Passover. And instead he found a cheating and corrupt marketplace in the middle of the temple. The temple, a place of prayer, had been turned into a place of profit. This was also the time that the temple tithes were being received, and they had to be received in the coinage of the temple. Foreign currencies were not acceptable. To further exacerbate the problem, foreigners were being taken advantage of by being charged exorbitant prices to have their money changed into the proper coinage. Remember, the Jews were the ones that were to usher in the salvation of the world by their righteous behavior. Jesus knew. Jesus saw that his fate was certain. Corruption was evident. There was no other choice but the way of the cross.